Welcome everyone to another live stream. I bought a book. I thought maybe, actually, by the way, did I not use that also? Yeah, failure. Actually, I wanted to show it like that. Thought it's funny. Anyway, bought a book. Maybe that's recommendable for you, not a paid advertisement though. Let's see. Maybe we are live. Another of those fun talking days. We have here this exact image that we maintain for over a decade already, since 2005, open source exact image processing. We created this initially actually as a set of C++ programs because the customer asked us, hey, this exact this image magic is so slow, can you not make this faster? And we looked into this. Image magic is not the most optimized, at least it wasn't in 2005, and maybe it still is not today. Back in the day, not sure if they changed it, maybe not, but for one thing, it doesn't support processing in all kind of bit devs. So as far as I remember, at least a decade ago, maybe still today, they upscale everything to at least 8-bit. So all the 1-bit black and white or 2-bit gray or 4-bit gray, which we support, and the customer mostly desperately needed 1-bit black and white and also 8-bit gray. But this was super slow, especially 2005. We didn't yet had multi-core gigahertz stuff. So yeah, and initially exact image was just a set of small programs that just did one job very well, like lightning fast, like 10 times faster than image magic. And since then I grew it in a huge C++ library. So initially that they paid their €1,000 there, maybe €2,000 there, something of that sort. And later they also actually paid for barcode recognition. So this also includes open source, one of the first open source barcode recognition. And most of the stuff I've done myself. So for example, they did not ask us, make this more like nicer C++ code. So over the years, I developed and researched, for example, we use relatively cool C++ templates. And I also like generic code for all those bit devs and still have relatively well optimized code. And so they have not paid for this. So over the years, I kept maintaining this. We have in total certainly earned less than €10,000 with this. And most of this was mostly one customer initially. And again, over the years, they have financed less than 5% of the code. And so they have not contacted us for a decade because basically they learned so much from me. I would say that they unfortunately could do most of the stuff themselves. They also paid for some T2 stuff and such. They actually use T2 Linux. And that's also the problem, right? They don't have much Linux experience or programming experience, especially in C++ and shell and Linux kernel, all this kind of stuff. And then people learn from you. They are of course not stupid. They watch you and say, ah, you do this, is how you're doing it. And then after a couple of years, they don't need you anymore. And so we kept totally improving this. So as I said, 95% of the code base is rewritten and now mostly nice C++. And the only reason actually I still keep maintaining this is because we use exact image in part also in our commercial software. So this from the very first beginning, I said we make this dual license GPL or a binary only commercial license from us if someone wants to commercially license this. This is why exact image from the first day was GPL or binary only licensing from the copyright holder, which is me, or exact code GmbH. And the only reason I kept maintaining this actually, which is by the way over the years an enormous amount of work, when we take a look here on the change log 2000, so we are just like yesterday a revision 2345 of our unsuccessful one-man stuff. Because by the way, fun fact, on exact image at least 4 developers worked: me, a former partner of us, another PhD intern, and a friend of mine. So at least 4 people of our unsuccessful one-man Linux distribution and exact code company. So 4 developer over 15 years now, and in total finance less than €10,000, I would estimate. Why do I tell you this? So first of all, we have not earned a single cent, I guess, the last decade. So for 10 years, people might or might not be using it. Sometimes people contacted us because it has support for layering an the output of Tesseract or other open source OCR engines. So this is one of the few programs. Well, actually, probably it's one of it's the first program that produced PDF, a PDF text layer. It's the program of exact images called OCR2, HOCR2 PDF, I guess, something of that sort. And this is sometimes over the years, people contacted me, hey, it doesn't work with the latest version of Tesseract anymore, because the Google people, of course, kept changing this. The XML output is now completely different. Certainly that doesn't pass anymore because changes. And I always replied, oh, yeah, I'm not interested in Tesseract. If you want to pay us some hours, we could probably take a look. And not once did someone from the maybe 10 contacts come back. So why do I tell you this today? Of course, here our story time. And there you see how much do we invest, our small, unsuccessful, not one man company, for 10 years donating open source, right, exact image. And you see here how many changes are this. I'm not making this shit up. So the last time we can scroll here, this scrolls here quite a lot. By the way, all this changes without, this is of course public changelog here on svnexarch.de. And all of those changes without author and stuff is actually the test suite. The test suite is not public because it often contains also customer images and stuff. And also, even if it would not, I would not even on top of the open source donate the amazing test suite. And fun fact, nobody paid us for the test suite, right? So initially, the first few years, we didn't have a test suite. We only we changed code if the feature was wanted or we improved something. And of course, sometimes there were regressions. And eventually, after a regression or two, it even got on my own nerves and I started a test suite. So the whole test suite, which in total now have hundreds of tests, like loading all the image formats, converting the, scaling this, all kinds of fun stuff. Yeah, test suite, nobody paid, also enormous, monstrous job over the years. You see, I scrolled here a bunch, we are only in 2005, again, everything not paid by anyone, 2010. So here we are getting in the territory, this were one of the last changes that are paid. So this is maybe around a revision, you know, even 2009, this was for sure not paid by someone anymore. Yeah, for example, here, this is also my fun stuff. So yeah, here, so this is 2008, you see thousand revisions of code and test suite features and improvements, optimizations and test suite and bug fixes that we found ourselves over the years. Nobody paid for this. Some people might be using it or not. It's a Debian package and maybe some other distributions. Why do I tell you this? A little bit of history. And now to the point, yesterday this company called me again after a decade. Spoke about, they actually found my breaking news and unsuccessful YouTube videos here and said, yeah, by the way, but Linux is amazing, everything else sucks. Yeah, okay, whatever. Thanks for calling. But so we talked, they had some different opinion, whatever. And then they said, by the way, your exact image, we didn't update for a decade because version 0.72, in the meantime, we are at version 1.0.2 or 3 or something. So they have not updated the exact image for a decade because at version 0.7.2 or so, it started not to work anymore. They use, we have script language bindings with SWG and it probably works for many languages, but tested and supported and at once upon a time working are Perl because that's what they're using, Python just for the fun of it. So you see, they wanted Perl bindings, we did this maybe for, I don't know, €500, just estimating something, as just a couple of hours. SWG, because not to recode all of this language bindings for each and every language, and because SWG, just checking the audio, SWG is a script language binding generator stuff, and so there you see, they paid a little bit for Perl a couple of hours, and we for free just added, just for the testing fun of it and just to have it and test a little bit. We tested, it wasn't a big work, but just we tested and made sure it works with Python, Ruby and Lua just for the fun of it. And yeah, so they have not even contacted us, right? So for a decade, they said nothing. They never came like, hey, there is an issue, can you fix this in an hour or two? We'd like to pay you 100 or 200 euro. So for 10 years, like we phoned sometimes like every two or three, it's not often. So You see, how often did they call us? Like every 2 or 3 years. Haha, how are you doing? Everything fine? Yeah, fine. Okay, how's life? Yeah, this and that. Okay, fine. Keeping in touch. Okay, fine. Whatever. But never did they say, maybe a year ago, he said, by the way, we have since 10 years a problem with exact image, but nothing like, oh, we fix it. Okay, whatever. So this email, unfortunately, German, because whatever. So we have your Google Translate. I could have translated that on the fly, but I wanted to have this a little bit fair. And documenting here, how does it work in the open source community, right? And to be fair, they financed initially a fair bit there that is sums up cool stuff. However, it also takes some recurring finances, right? So the last decade, again, recurring reminder, we have done for free just. And again, if we would not have used this in our commercial products, which, by the way, fun fact, in our commercial products, we have much more. Not only do we have plenty of more algorithms, why should I open source them? So ExactImage is a base library. And on top of this, we have plenty of more amazing image processing algorithms that we need in ExactImage and OCRKit and Recompress and even our UI runtime. We also, in the open source version, we have support to use libjpeg, libtiff, libpng. But because I didn't like libtiff and libpng and stuff in our closed source improved in-house version, we even have more image codecs. So for example, we have TIFF support without libtiff, like our own C++ code that is much more readable and amazing. We have our own PNG codec, because also more amazing, and a couple of other stuff. A better JPEG 2000 library, open source. We have just a Jasper binding to a Jasper open JPEG 2000 library. And closed source or internal open source, internal source, we have a better binding for JPEG, OpenJPEG, which is we found later a better library. But why should we open source this components that nobody pays us for and people would just use, right? So they used this for a decade and never bothered to just even pay us an hour or two of fixing a small problem. And this email thread, and yes, I'm totally aware I might burn my last bridges, but in the meantime, I didn't earn a single cent with them or with most open source for those decades. So in the meantime, YOLO, whatever, I don't earn much anyway. And so on the phone, I speculated, because he only said it doesn't work for them, doesn't work, crashes, doesn't work. Okay, could be anything, right? Better bug report would also, he could have said this particular function crashes. He only said doesn't work. Okay. Then I said, yeah, maybe it's Zwick. There was like Zwick 3, this script language binding stuff. I could only speculate, right? Developer's best guess. Could also be something broken in Debian, because in the meantime they switched to Debian. Could be anything. Certainly takes an hour or two to take a look, see what's exactly going on there. Also, I don't personally use those script language bindings. So whatever, right? I can't test everything for free for decades. And so this email again left a copy. Also the email, he often replied without the context and top post. And yeah, so I copied this here together. So this email, so as he said yesterday, by the way, so I said maybe an hour or two, then yeah, you want to pay this, like, yeah, maybe, yeah, okay. What do you take? I said, yeah, in the meantime, we take more, like, because back in the day, we probably took like 50 euro, like totally low end, because we were a startup and just from university and stuff, didn't overcharge. In the meantime, it's more like industry standard 100 euro rate, which probably still is cheap, but whatever. Even that, most people don't want to pay. In the meantime, I don't even care too much anymore. I said, yeah. In the meantime, we take more like industry standard rate 100 euro, but if you want to pay less, it's also fine, whatever, 1 or 2 hours, whatever. So there you see how flexible I am. I'm already not, no, this is, you need to pay this, like, yeah, this in the meantime, it's more like this, but if you don't really pay it, then yeah, then less or whatever. So, and I started to take a look, and to my surprise, because it sounded from phoning with him, like the Zwick language binding wouldn't work at all, and to my surprise, it just worked. I spent already 1 hour just going there to my exact image, testing this. And so you see, also I spent most of the time actually, because the only thing that didn't work was Ruby. And then I was a little bit blind myself. I also can't invoice when I'm personally too stupid. I spent there like 20 minutes debugging around on the Ruby stuff and in the make files. I'm just wondering why does this Ruby stuff not build until I figured, oops, it's commented out in the make file. So lesson learned, relook in your make files, and it was commented out in the top level make file. So I fixed for free also the Ruby people. The reason I probably saw it probably a decade ago, this Ruby stuff didn't build anymore. So because nobody was using it, I just commented it out. And then until recently, a decade later, I wondered why does it not build anymore? I forgot it myself. And I actually, to my surprise, it just worked. So probably only because the Ruby people changed really stupid for, maybe later, they changed for each release a package config. So they have Ruby-1.7. So I had there in the configure script, I checked for Ruby-1.7 and probably that didn't work and whatever was there conflicting. And it's also, in my opinion, slightly stupid that apparently each Ruby release bumps this package config file. That means I would need to iterate in the configure script or Manson stuff. I would need to iterate all the Ruby versions just. But anyway, I bumped the version to the latest whatever we had in T2 and it just worked. So not even sure why I commented it out a decade ago, except maybe it wasn't found anymore. Something of that sort. So I already spent there quite some minutes fiddling around. I worked, so I wrote there back, for me it somehow works. I would probably need to test with UXHackDebl installation because for me right now on the first look, nothing even really wrong with it. So much to blaming, yeah, you broke something in the last decade. And as there you see with the summary, how long even from the summary you see, how much time goes there? You phone, you test, so this and that, and at the end nobody really wants to pay for stuff. And so then I stopped at this because I wrote him, I probably need to install your Debian. And then he wrote like, yeah, I take a look, something. Then I said, okay, he takes a look, then I stop working because why should I in parallel when he fiddles around himself there? So, okay. And then, so as he wrote, as I said yesterday, if I'm on the current exact image library, change depends on how well. So because he said, he talked to me like, if he would, he made it sound like a product choice, like to choose to go to the latest version of the product, which is like, I'm not earning money from this, right? I don't care if you use the latest version with bug fixes and security fixes, or if he uses a decade old version with other security stuff that we fix in the meantime. I mean, I don't earn a single cent, right? He makes it like we need to fix something that he can switch to the latest version. If it's not possible for your time or financial reasons, supporting exact image for these platforms, now would be the time to talk about it. It's not just for the current case, but of the general nature for the next 5 or 10 years. I'm not saying that this should not cost anything, but I mean open source per se means taking care of such things. So he implies like it needs to work in general from what we supply to the public, which by the way, fun fact, works for me. We even built up a test suite with hundreds of tests, and on a short test it even worked for me. And so there you see, you can't, for a decade we earned nothing, and then if someone comes, then they say, yeah, but excuse me, it needs to work, right? I can't switch to this if it doesn't work, even if it's only a totally small thing of an hour or 2 hours to fix. And this is exactly the recurring, this is also why I share this here with the public, although totally aware that he might be pissed sharing these emails, but whatever. And then I replied, what exactly you mean with this, quoting here with, in German, is if it's not possible for time or financial reasons. I mean, for my time or financial reasons when I already earn nothing with this. And there you see the double moral. Everyone wants open source, but if it comes to paying for something, financing something, fixing something, then it's like, yeah, but it doesn't work. I can't use it if it doesn't work. It's like, what? And then he continued, of course, you do not have to do, but I think it would end up much more than if you did not do it. And yes, it's like it, at the end, it would be more viable if you do it. The Google translation is not the most amazing AI in 2019, machine learning and stuff, you know. I did not say that you should not take any money for it. But yeah, but you see, just instead of paying 1 or 2 hours, he writes so long emails. In the time dealing with those emails already takes the same time like me just fixing the issue. it's like only it's just that something that is going to run in the latest version should also in the later version should also or runs as the Google Translation is total bullshit. Something that was just he said something that was working should also work in the latest version. It's like, yeah, bugs can also happen. So first of all, in my opinion, we took an extremely great care. Although nobody paid us 1,000 revisions of optimizations, new features, new algorithms, new image codecs, even open source. We didn't keep everything closed. A test suite, a huge test suite that runs and catched also issues and so on. We should take care of our library that people can use it, but nobody wants to pay for it. People can only use it, but not pay for it if it works. So something broke. So we took enormous efforts that nobody paid for. It works for us and nobody else complained except for the cuneiform XML input, which we didn't break, they broke. And nobody wants to pay for improving that. And so something broke for what he's using. But then he even said, yeah, but excuse me, it's like you have to fix this for people to be able to use it. And this is the sad thing. We only talk about 1 or 2 hours. And even this is such a discussion. And this is why I rather live stream this now, burn the last bridges in the meantime. Because with this kind of emails, I only get depressive. The emails waste my time instead of doing something useful on our products or even doing this actually work, which, fun fact, I already committed there for free. The last revision is actually commenting in, bumping the Ruby version and commenting this in again, which wasn't only Rivas typo. But this is not too much. There are some example scripts. It's not too much of a change. But here, update configure script for the latest Ruby version and re-enable Ruby SWG API binding. This was only 2-line change. Everyone could done this the last decade. Then he even says, yeah, it's like it does not bring anything as a translation of shit. Doesn't bring anything to anyone. If the code is broken and is not maintained, and if it doesn't run on operating system X or Y, it's like it runs on T2, the Debian people have a package, we run it on macOS in our products, and we even run it in our Windows products. And fun fact, for free, I even fixed there some stuff, if certainly for our own use, that it compiles with Visual Studio, which I, by the way, fun fact, if anyone would ever write me, hey, I have an issue here with Visual Studio, I would always charge them, right? My only email, if someone says it doesn't work with Visual Studio, always like, okay, here are our financial terms, we like zero support for free commercial operating systems. But yeah, this is my life with open source, amazing stuff, right? 2019, even for a 1 or 2 hour job. In the meantime, I could reproduce this. So in the meantime, he could extract a Perl 5 liner, and it's only one function, so much too, it crashes. Yeah, okay, it is one function. And this is with, by the way, I might have, let's hope I don't disclose here, which also I have not. It's a floating point, so it's not like a crash, it's like a board crash of a floating point exception, so most likely division by zero or something. Yeah, it most likely is a division by zero in a thumbnail filter. It's a very special box filter. For performance reasons, so whatever is going on there with floating point rounding, so most likely because this is filtering in fixed rectangular boxes for some high-speed thumbnailing. But then again, it works. We probably may be using it, but we don't have a single crash for this, and also I don't have a test suite failure. So you see, you can have a test suite with hundreds of tests, and you still might not have 100% coverage. You might always be a customer coming with one special fractional scaling that is causing a floating point exception because due to the layout of the filters. It might actually be because he's calling it explicitly the thumbnail scaling. And in our library, we might only, because we have a helper function for that, like scale something, and this scale probably switches between linear and anyway. It might even be that we don't use it explicitly in our own commercial project or something. But there you see one function. So he could, 10 years ago, he could already tell us, hey, this version update is throwing a floating point exception. But here we are a decade later, and then you even discuss 1 or 2 hours and such long emails of philosophical stuff about, yeah, but it, you know, it should actually work, right? And this also makes me feel really bad, right? And first of all, I donate so much. These are thousands of hours that only pay through our commercial products that are even open source, right? Exact Image GPL or binary commercial license. And then people argue with me like, yeah, but by the way, like seriously, it should actually more like work, right? Because it once worked and you broke it, and it's like, yeah, and this is why I turn to YouTube live streamings, and at least I have some fun and something. So don't make the mistake of thinking. And so actually the first pages here of this amazing book, which I probably spoiled a little bit at the beginning when I didn't have this, like how I wanted this was by actually YouTube live streaming was, again, as usual, not live streaming instantly. And the first pages here in the preface actually of Snowden's public permanent record, although a totally different thing, but he writes in the preface about the internet and how the internet in the very beginning was like not about commercial internet, but a free exchange of ideas, and not like exchange of goods and commercial e-commerce stuff. And when I was reading this today, it was like totally matching this situation when I was thinking like 20 years ago when we contributed to Rock Linux, we were really thinking like to create a more fair or something world and society, but with all the GNU and Free Software Foundation stuff. But I have to come to the conclusion after 20 years, it's nearly impossible to earn money. I said this before, you can watch the previous videos. I will not reiterate all the other stuff. There is more to this than this. But it's nearly impossible to earn money. You always, so first of all, nobody pays you to create an open source product. So if you create something like Exact Image, and by the way, we also created GSMP with a friend of mine before Exact Code, the GSMP, General Sound Manipulation Program, which yes, we have not maintained in 18 years or something, which back in the day, 2000, we used for multi-track CD recording as a hobby. And so we have not only with GSMP, Exact Image and Rock Linux NT2 and all the patches over the years, constantly keeping stuff working and fixing and stuff, nobody pays you for this. And even if you make something like GSMP or Exact Image, even then people don't want to pay for this. Why should they pay? Either it is broken and they don't use it. And if it's even the tiny littlest, just the super smallest floating point regression, then they say, yeah, but you know what, actually it should work, right? I mean, it's your regression. Yeah, so it's like charge for support, charge for documentation. But honestly, like the Blender also went bankrupt. This, what was it, 9-inch nails? Was it NIN or no, was it something of that sort? Whatever, the Blender was previously, when they were bankrupt, now open source, something. Blender people also tried to charge for support and documentation, and then people blamed them. They made the program too complex and too error prone and hard to use and learning curve to use, just so that they sell support and documentation. And also with the thing with selling support and documentation, first of all, nobody wants to pay for support and documentation. And if the program, either the program works, then they do not need to support and documentation. And if it doesn't work, they don't want to use it. Nobody will come to you like, hey, your program is so hard to use, I can't use it. Now please support me and I want to pay for this. Isn't it the whole situation? And the only thing, I said this before, the only companies and people who become richer and richer are big companies who base their stuff on open source, like Google, Facebook, Red Hat, no, IBM, and all the other fun stuff in between, certainly all the internet. And another thing is, it's not like we open source people, we are not running around and having some open source sign on the forehead or nose or somewhere. If I recently went to the teeth doctor, made a video about this below, should also go more often to the dental doctor there, I had more caries than I thought. I thought I have no problems. And then after 10 years, you go there. Do I get a discount for some plastic filling there that I need to pay additionally in Germany? Of course not. You cannot go to the doctor. But by the way, I do like half of my life. I donated 10,000 hours to open source. Can I get a discount? It's just like, what the heck are you even talking about? Do I get a discount at a coffee for a flight? Do I get a discount at some airline because they run their servers on Linux? Of course not. Do I get a discount on a Google Nexus? Of course not. It's not, in my opinion, by the way, first of all, certainly for the future, because in a couple of decades, we have certainly with all the automation, even less jobs. So in the meantime, basic income, exactly for this kind of reason. Second of all, those people who contribute to the community, be it social service, helping elderly or handicapped people or open source or all the other stuff, should, in my opinion, get also some other discount benefits, because you see, you earn no money, you pay the full price everywhere anyway. So the whole thing, why in the meantime, it is hopeless. If I would not have my commercial products like Exact Scan and OC Arcade, so don't delay, buy some paperless office stuff today like Exact Scan, OC Arcade, Recompress. They are down on our amazing, probably I should list it here, website, right? Fun fact, our products sales are up. So the only thing that keeps us here alive and stuff is that. And of course, our growing YouTube and Patreon revenue here. Thank you for everyone for subscribing here or on Patreon and donating there. That is amazing stuff. And what do we have here? People say, hello, welcome everyone. I think too many associate open source with free beer. And yeah, then the fun stuff is I didn't believe, and people here in those comments, so much to learn. I learned not only features of Less and other amazing packages here from you guys, but also people told me here Linus Torvalds' salary is over a million, 1.2 million with pension and whatever health benefits, which is also a little bit crazy, right? So many people contribute, and a couple, not that he should not get some money, but 1.2 million is maybe also a little bit hefty. He certainly deserves a good salary, but this is also a little bit, yeah, most of the community gets nothing, and some flagship, someone people get their huge stuff, then maybe this should also be a little bit more fair spread, which in my opinion, Linus Torvalds of course does something, but honestly, nowadays he's mostly merging patches, which also some intern could do probably, but yeah, amazing that so many people tune in. I could say quite some more stuff. I could have slightly. By the way, if you're interested, I yesterday of all the fun stuff worked on SGI patches. So fun stuff is coming up there. And in the meantime, someone contacted me yesterday from Irix SGI fame, of asking whether I would be interested for fun. Of course, not like, hey, I pay you, but hey, wouldn't you be interested to write USB support for Irix? It's like, yeah. And it's like, yeah, I could also send you, maybe try someone to donate you this PCI support shoebox or shoehorn thing. And the only reason I accepted this, like, yeah, so fun fact next on this, trying to write USB stick. So only, but this is for the next video. The only reason I accepted to, yeah, we could look into this, is because I anyway have for my microkernel and low level stuff USB on my agenda, so I said, yeah, why not do low-level USB stuff in QEMU and low-level bare metal stuff for education and stuff, and then, yeah, if you already want to do it anyway, try to get it to run on Irix. So fun stuff coming up here, and this certainly is more amazing joy than dealing with people who tell me such kind of stuff. Let's open here some, by the way, we could probably SSH directly to Rise, which hopefully doesn't show. Oh, wait a second, to Rise. Should have said, why does this not work? Maybe this doesn't have a password. I don't know, maybe this could be. So that is that. And yeah, so that is here an exact image, and which is also not the right directory. Which is also in source, exact image, by the way, I hope there was not an IP address. And then examples, Perl, so test, okay, so this works, so this also only crashes on black and white, probably that. So yeah, floating point exceptions. And then the fun stuff also, first he said, like, it crashes even when compiling, when it was only like GCC aborting. This is also the fun fact people tell you. It crashes when it's only like stops compiling because the GCC is a little bit too restrict now because of some code I've not tweaked in quite some time. So yeah, that is that. Yeah, otherwise, and there you see how important it is that people also tell you precisely what's going on, because just it doesn't work or crashes doesn't cut it. It's like, yeah, what exactly, right? But yeah, if you have any solutions to this, I have actually accept Patreon, and which totally is amazing because we have so much more stuff. And certainly not only exact image, right? I scrolled over the changes here, which again, 1,000 changes. And again, so what kinds did we do here? Fixed stricter compiler warnings. eDisplay has even new window root stuff, which actually, fun fact, I use here for the amazing, so this is, I've only done for my own fun to have here, also can we probably here, where's my, why does this, oh, we have a shell there, oh, fun stuff. Like, here's this amazing background because all the other background stuff. So yeah, even new feature, all this side project. But I got a little bit tired of using background setting that only supports patterns and solid colors. And yeah, even new feature, just for the fun of it, the fun stuff you do. Also, maybe exact image might be faster than some other tools. Okay, some... yeah, renamed for some better readability or whatever, but even micro optimizations. TGA, so some codecs are even open source. It's not like, so for example, I've written a TGA, this Targa format codec, just for the fun of it. So it's not like I kept all codecs I've written privately, even some I open source just for the fun of it. By the way, fun fact, if you ever need this, I will probably, but commercially only, next I will most likely write a image codec for the DICOM medical image format, but why should I open source it? Of course, I keep it for myself, right? Because if I open source it, people will just use it, never donate a single cent back to me, except it's also a fun fact, right? In the meantime, students and fans like you donate in the meantime more than companies with $2 a month at Patreon. Implemented even TGA. Initially, I had only TGA uncompressed. I also implemented RLE. Probably I've also implemented BMP, RLE decompression. Updated also only for my own fun and stuff. I have there integrated DC RAW. I think nobody ever wanted RAW image. So if you want, of course, in the meantime, there's also LibRAW and whatever, but which probably I should actually, fun fact, probably use. Wait a second, some more working. Why do I have in 2017 Ruby working when I actually then I have not commented it out too long when I've here started Ruby example script, actually not really sure. Fun fact, for those who stay here really to the last minute, once that is really set, there are a couple of missed opportunities that I regret. Once a really high-end German audio company contacted us, and we made a relatively a decade ago when Exacode was young, and they wanted multimedia. We offered them T2 in for some multimedia living room stuff, like, but really high end, like really one of the most luxury German high fidelity stuff. And we offered a fair price because you need to calculate, right? If you commercially support some embedded Linux, you need to calculate not even doing the initial solution for some ARM board in their high end audio system, which they sold, by the way, fun fact, their components costs 10,000 to 100,000 of euro, right? And so this needs to be really working like totally rock solid. You can't make there a cheap offer and then it doesn't really work much. So we made a relatively fair offer. I, by the way, fun fact, probably need to check what we offered them, but it certainly was in the ballpark of 100,000 euro, but I need to check. This figure included like a couple of developers like me and like two or three to really work on this, because board support package for this stuff, also some multimedia stuff and some integration and work, also over the course of a year or two, right? This is not 100,000 euro for a month. This is for a project, for like really supporting it, a project, in my opinion, a fair number. And they didn't want it. They like nearly didn't speak with us anymore, which was a little bit, they are selling themselves 10 to 100,000 euro components. And then like like they are pissed because the offer was reasonable. But that would have been a cool project. But the problem is, this is the thing: you offer something dirt cheap, but in the meantime, it's like recently because I repaired my own or like got it first working my own DAC. There's this digital analog converter board that I built 20 years ago and never worked and just fixed recently when I finally got it to work. There in the videos with fine crystal chips and even a Motorola DSP, amazing stuff. When I did this 2 years ago in the beginning of this YouTube channel, I really was thinking like, wow, this was such a high-end company. This is really a pity that this project didn't become something. And I spoke with someone in Berlin because I met someone there with this digital stuff, there with this deck, who himself had a company 10 years ago for this deck stuff and high-end stuff. And I spoke with him like, by the way, do you know this and that? And the founder of the company said, yeah, I know this and that, but you know, he passed away some years ago. I said, no, I didn't know this. I was like, oh, sorry to hear that. May you rest in peace. But so fast time passes, but this would have been working with really this kind of, but there you see the richest audiophile companies, even they are totally pissed if you make them a reasonable embedded Linux board support offer from company to company for really on a business professional level supporting a project over a year or two or three in the lifetime of this really needs to be rock solidly working and not some piece of garbage. But yeah, so much to fun projects that could have been but have not been. What else? You are so optimized copy compact data to native strides. I even implemented initially, as I said, exact image is so fast because it works natively on 1, 2, 4, so not only 1 and 8 bit and 16 bit, it even exact image even works natively, natively meaning not upscaling this in memory, in even 2 and 4 bit gray data. Very few software is doing that. And even then, so the only thing is from the very beginning, I didn't want it to deal with the image stride having some padding. And because I needed this, so originally the image data had to be completely like without any padding on the strides of the raw data of each pixel raw. And only because I wanted to optimize, micro optimize something for our own use case, I have completely rewritten all the image data handling and all the algorithms and image iterators. So we have an old image iterator, we have a new image iterator that is more high performance but a little bit more annoying to work with, and I have not yet converted all the old algorithms, so because nobody pays me, right? So some algorithms still use the old image pixel data iterator, generic template programming, and most of the new algorithms use the new one. And I had to change the old iterator, the new iterator, and some algorithms still use like raw, like C coded, open coded byte access, and to support strides with padding, like even like not even like 4 quad word line, but any arbitrary strides. For some parts of our commercial software. And again, this feature is open source, right? So a huge rework of all the data management layout stuff there. And the only one who paid for this is Exact Code for their our internal project. It's yet open source. And then people argue about an hour or two and that is there's some tiny regression. And yeah, fix the typo in Code Gen 8. Yeah, sometimes there's also a typo because also humans making a typo. Simplify and fix rest stripe, corner case, and PDF codec. Tech 09, better avoid causing regressions by preserving iOS some stream handling details, because often you write something and then a decade later you realize some stray STD behavior. Fix crash and invalid compression. Right, there was even an security something and even our stuff. Throw bit alloc if polytio location fails. Simplify something, whatever. Only log verbose DCT reuse. Support RGB A16 iteration. Also some typos, because typos. Support 16-bit palette image and optimized it slightly. Fun stuff. Edit support menu, yeah, so really many, yeah, not even 2016, there you see, you scroll 2016, again, all the commits in between test suite. Hope you learned something and probably you don't want to get an open source and why I'm increasingly even this T2 a little bit. So I'm of course still massively contributing to the T2 code base and we probably will make another live stream with an SGI machine. But yeah, totally interested to hear what you're thinking, how this can be fixed. I don't really see, except everyone has its own GoFundMe and Patreon page, but this is also hilarious, right? That open source developer need a GoFundMe and Patreon page. This certainly somehow is not scalable. And also why I lose respect for big companies, not only Apple, which certainly also sometimes use open source. They even, well, even WebKit, right? WebKit was KDE, KHTML from Conqueror, which by the way, fun fact, back in the day, I preferred also among the most. So even Apple took open source, not even to mention Next, Mach and BSD kernel there. And even Microsoft nowadays, Google, Amazon, everyone. And yeah, I don't really see a fix except not doing open source or, but this is also lesson learned. Never touch open source on any kind of business scale without anyone paying for this. Of course, I could not just like fix this and risk like nobody pays for this. I could also just fix it and make exact image better. But there you see, yeah, I don't know. We could also try to fix this live here. By the way, fun fact, have I compiled this with, there would even be probably here. We could actually try to take a quick look if we have compiled this with debugging symbols and have here GDB, object here, front end econvert, core, and no, we don't have debugging symbols apparently, but this is a Ryzen, so actually we, okay, this is commented out, so then let's, this is a Ryzen with quite some threads, so that's just a matter of, yeah, also there are some warnings because nobody pays me to get the warnings away. And some of the warnings are also stupid, like in the code generator templates, like, it's like unused variable, which is not really unused. I probably try to do something, but whatever. So yeah, if you later blame me, yeah, but I try to compile it, it doesn't build with something of the compiler. Yeah, it works for me, but why should I go here over all this? Also, these warnings are SWIG, so these are SWIG generated. It's like, yeah, seriously, whatever. So tests and not test suite, examples, and this was Perl test codam gdb. Why is there still no debugging symbol in there? Did I have here CS or something? S silently. Why are there no debugging symbols? Gdb. File object here, front end deconvert. Not stripped. What is this? Oh, wait a second, this is because it's a plugin of, oh, okay, then I need not front end, but GDB, this certainly doesn't match. User bin Perl, tiny synco, backtrace, hey, that matches. Yeah, so exactly as I expected, this is here, image scale CC. And by the way, a proper bug report would also be, by the way, this is a code line. I mean, people could also in a decade produce a patch, but at least they could tell me which code line it is already is written if they expect it. Fix for 3.6.7. 6.7 is, yeah, of course, so there are some box scaler boxes. Maybe this is even usability bug of, because the box is probably this. So even if I fix this, so the bug might even be like, but he said it worked with the old version, but you see, this is a box filter meaning filtering in boxes for very fast thumbnailing. And I think he had there some scaling factor. Maybe the scaling factor is also simply too low, but I mean, the strange is that he said it worked before, so whatever. Test, that was test PL. So this is scaling factor of 0.42. It should actually probably work though, but, or did I actually, there was once also, no, usually I don't do API changes, but Actually, GDB, do we see the argument for scale frame maybe in? So this is only frame 0. Image something scale here. It should probably not be an API change. So yeah, actually I don't think this should be division by 0, but yeah, then you need to think it's not even like a typo off by 1 or something. You really need to think what is happening there in the scaling. Why is the count of those, the count in the pixel count in the boxes 0, which may or may not have. Anyway, if you want to see some more amazing SGI streams, then leave in the comments below. Maybe we go big online in a minute, but you probably will agree the situation is really frustrating. And yeah, this is also, if my company, so fun fact, right, to finish this chain of thoughts, if my company would not had made end user products, we most likely would be bankrupt, right? Without ExactScan OCR kit, which make up huge portions of our revenue, we still have done something. I mentioned open source virtualization with macOS in a couple of videos for some Silicon Valley companies and some other bits and pieces here and there. But most of the stuff is even years ago, and most of the years we earned next to nothing with open source. So again, without commercial, where you wonder, yeah, but you have commercial projects, products, why are you doing this? But yeah, excuse me, I couldn't even run a company without them. We would be bankrupt already. So as poor as Trump, or as bankrupt as Trump a couple of times, apparently. Anyway, soon we have the next thing to do, but that is actually, but as we have still some people here, could actually, it's a little bit too curious. Actually, I wonder if this is reproducible with front end eConvert. This would probably be, let's see, help. I'm not running this each and every day. Do we have here, wait a second, why is this 2 and 1? Is it probably, hopefully, fully on screen, I hope. Live fixes. Thumbnail or squat count of scales. Do we have a big cubic linear DDT? Doesn't even. You see, this is a very special function for. Here's thumbnail. Quick and dirty downscale for thumbnail. Okay, here we have it. So the syntax is import. That was example. What was this even? That was it maybe 1PNG? Thumbnail 0.47 or so, output test PNG, floating point exception. But with this we can GDB lib that is in scale or image scale. What did I even thumbnail? Scale. So if the scale is only optimized to regular thumbnail, what only optimize the regular? Okay, because there you see with API decisions, you could of course pass a higher number in there, and then it is doing regular scaling, because otherwise you can't do the box scaling for boxes that are empty, right? So then you need normal linear scaling. So if someone is so stupid to put an upscaling and something scaling, then it still does something, does the right thing. But also it has support for partial JPEG scaling, transforming the DCT coefficients there. Integrated, you can do this with the JPEG DC something tools in libjpeg, but it's of course super nice when it's integrated, then it does an optimized thing if it can do, otherwise it's doing regular good old pixel scaling. So if the scaling, so we upscale quick and byte subscaling, a box scale, okay, there's actually some gray x to gray 8. Yeah, so there's one little, this is a little bit corner cases, right? It's a very special function, because if you scale, the point is, if you have black and white data and you scale this, it looks really ugly. So actually this is one of the very few algorithms, usually all the algorithms work on those data and retain this data, but for the thumbnail scaling, you won't want to have nice looking thumbnails, and then you want them grayscale, even though the picture was black and white. This is why then some kind of dithered pattern in black and white is scaling to some nice gray levels. You see, after a decade, I even need to read myself here what we have done here. So if this is gray stuff, then make it gray. I slightly wonder why is book scale okay. Gray, any gray to gray 8, okay. Otherwise color space, so we make this gray RGB and not floating point data or something. Box scale, where did this even 600 something, right? Was it 630 whatever? Ah, here was divided by count, yeah, so that is which function. Yeah, also modern C++, historically we used, what is even the term there, variable sized arrays or something, but the Microsoft C compiler or C-Lang do not, also maybe C-Lang, the latest version of C-Lang, actually I made a bug report a decade ago that C-Lang doesn't support this, and I think they eventually implemented it for plain old data types. But Microsoft Visual Studio still doesn't support this, so we use standard vectors there for that. So yeah, this is any gray X to that. I slightly really wonder that there's probably some fancy floating point rounding going on here. Because bind X, int bind X, pre-compute box indexes, box index, yeah, but even after you abbreviated variables, after a decade, so box indexes. So we pre-compute box indexes not to have to scale them, right? A little bit micro-optimization, there you see performance optimization. It is faster to pre-compute all the indexes for the boxes that if you downscale, in which box you put this pixel for scaling, than to scale this with multiplication. So this is scale x sx multiplied integer, so minimum of z. Actually sx maybe, what is scale x here, could actually be some integer versus multi scale x, no this is float, scale x, so that is float multiplied by scale x by sx is an integer, actually looks quite right. Minimum of multiplied this with which with minus 1 looks also relatively okayish. Don't really quite. So on the first glance that looks even okayish. Gray look up. Yeah, this is a little bit extremely heavy optimized. This was actually one of the algorithms we did for them, but there could also be whatever compiling boxes dx plus gray look up this level. Bit shift. Yeah, this is one of those algorithms that are still not using modern iterators, that are hand optimized bit shifting for the highest possible performance. Amazing stuff, right? The problem is, so probably, so you could of course set a breakpoint e-convert. So that would be like that if you want to learn low-level breakpointing stuff. But yeah, teaching more people how to fish, and then even more people don't pay me, but whatever. At least I have you here in the audience. GDB break on... that was either... Do we still have... No, we don't. Image scale... See 620 something. Or better thumbnail. Okay, thumbnail scale break on thumbnail scale that run with that. Next, What? Why did this? Ah, this trapped. Break there. Del break one. Run again with all of this. Oh, wait a second. This was running it wrong. Run with right arguments. Oh, wait a second. Scale X is actually. I've not fixed. Maybe I refactored that wrong because once upon a time, initially, we didn't have support for this fixed size scaling. Actually, is it possible? What is here? So, but if not fixed, okay, that is a new total width. New image. Ah. How did I paste that though? New image with that image. What? Okay, that is a new width so far. New image resize to that. Set resolution to scaled. So when we print this block box indexes, they are right now zero, which actually we don't initialize, but whatever, we should, we fill them here all from zero to image width. So if we print this out again, we have here one, wait a second, somehow doesn't look right, right? Scale X multiplied by SX. So scale X is a new type, newish. So this is a new resolution, which by the way, I could also, fun fact, write slightly more optimized, not that it matters much, but scale X should already be the correct resolution. Yeah, debugging numerical instability, fun stuff here live on YouTube. Yeah, also my most favorite debugger stuff, variable value has been optimized out. Thank you for that amazing debugger. There's actually some strange stuff here going on with that. Alright, a second. Yeah, I probably defected this algorithm because this is pixels, so this is multiple times. Wait a second, this is why. Okay, I see the bug already. And I probably don't have a test suite for this because not triggering this box scaling stuff that we usually don't run manually. 13, what do we have here? I'm going to question, but is it a bit off topic trying to build native? Oh, okay, GCC, the script is already, it's already too long, GCC no executables. I've checked it to an account, seem to be patched address issue. Just wanted to have you. Probably too long to take a look into that. Maybe something for another live stream, but maybe you just built T2, although actually I didn't commit at all the Musl stuff yet. Anyway, the stream is as usual already super too long and then nobody watches it and people tell me the streams are too long. But fun fact, so this is probably, I defected myself, this is most likely, well, he already figured it's a regression because it doesn't work, but there you see, an regression, it's also not only me to blame. I did a test suite and I tried to cover a lot of stuff. I load a lot of image, so I synthetically have created a lot of image formats of BMP, TGA, TIFF, and also fun stuff in different, like 1-bit, 2-bit, 4-bit, 8-bit, 24-bit, and even 16-bit sometimes, and do a lot of algorithms. And yeah, he just happens to use the one that I overlooked, and yeah, also human and everything. Yes, so theoretically, I could actually have run some code coverage. But yeah, did someone pay me for this? Like running GCC and tracking code coverage of running the test suite and then seeing what the code path would be. But again, this is a multi-day effort, maybe a whole week of doing this systematically and stuff and then creating test suite. So, and he knew it is broken for a decade and didn't tell us for a decade. So yeah, so because what if I refactored initially, exact image only had support for a scaling factor like scaling 2, 4, or 0.5, 1.5 and all the other whatever you want to do. And then some people asked, and by the way, fun fact, I think nobody paid me for that. Some people wrote me, hey, exact image is amazing, but I want to scale precisely to 1024 pixels. But if I set the floating point factor like 0.213456 something, I get 1023 pixels because of the amazing floating point rounding, right? And usually I said, yeah, I'm not interested, whatever, you can send a patch. But eventually, I probably eventually wanted for this for myself. So you see, probably 5 people over 15 years have asked, like open source or Debian and stuff. Nobody ever wanted to even donate. And by the way, so much amazing that you watch and subscribe on Patreon. And this feature, most likely, I just have implemented for myself for the fun of it. This is why here is this bool argument fixed. And this is fixed. It is using this scale x and y as fixed integers, which, fun fact, all the floating point with all the fractional bit zero can be represented in regular double floating point up to, I think, 42 bits, whatever the exponent and mantissa there was. So all of those can be precisely represented in floating point stuff, right? If you use float, then it's less, that is 32, it's probably 23 bit or something of that sort. You can look this up in whatever bits mantissa and exponent was there of those. So yeah, most likely I defected this at scale x equals, so if not fixed, then that. And so this needs to be something of the sort of scaling, where is it even, the pre-computed box index. So probably this is only fixing the box index here. And this is here. So previously SX was a scaling factor, which now it isn't anymore. So we need, actually, wait a second, I misspoke already. We actually compute this here. Wait a second, this probably should be new with this of new with. So actually no, because SX is not the scaling factor, but the index into that. There is even the minimum of, hello, where is min of thumb? Was there not some minimum in there of something scale Z? Hello? Nah. Gray. Or do we have gray? Do we call this box? Box scale. By the way, do we have drop frames? This stuff is getting a little bit hot though. Foreground one, next program. There is no program to run. What? Is it another debugger? Kidding me? How many jobs do I have here? Damn it. Break in gray something. Box scale template. Oh, by the way, does this template work? Maybe I have here in this imaginary code box index SX new image with. And what do I have in the. Boxes, box scale, then yeah, here is really box scale that, yeah, box scale probably left this really box scale, where is it even here. I really left here some hand-optimized bit code. Really should get away with it and use the templates. Nothing highly optimized Mem said, can clear fast. I really have a different algorithm here. There, I had just SX B index. So maybe I fix the generic code path. So that is SX of this truncated to integer. And here I really had something else in there. Probably this was nearly. So probably only the generic, more generic code triggers for some reason. And anyway, where is it now? Bindex equals, so bindex sx, so this is scale x multiplied by sx. Yeah, this is clearly, yeah, this is clearly wrong and limiting against the new image width. So this is not only simpler, but most likely also more correct. Yes, and if you cannot see all the warnings, then you can donate and pay us to get all the warnings away. Why is this compiling so long though? No, probably not two, but 60 nowadays, huh? Yep, bug fixing only live. So image, iron, thumbnail, still floating point. Scale template, maybe copy this output code, maybe that is helpful. B index here. And by the way, in the meantime, maybe I can even make a video about coding style. My coding style changed quite significantly over the years. Not that probably everyone, so this is not our, I also, fun fact, I don't rediff this, like run this through some C indent whatever stuff, because then it would change all, it would change if I hunt a regression and I SVN blame or git blame, then it would only show the last change where I read and indented the code. So this is, in my opinion, just leave old code how it is and only touch it if you change it, in my opinion. Although this results a little bit of mixed coding style, but in my opinion, the benefits of having a better SVN or git like blame history outweighs this very small stuff. So this still floating point except, but most likely this already fixed some issue. Let's also lock this in the log. So 0, 0. So you see all those pixels there go into one box of those. That looks pretty reasonable, like either 2 or 3 or something pixels there in a row for this 47% scaling. Why does it still floating point except? Also, obviously, being a professional, I will also off camera create a test suite in our secret test suite for that. So where are we still? Counts. Somehow the counts are, which dx is this p, but probably dx0 already for the first pixel. Because it's dividing by the box count. This is really 0 though. Is the first a 0? Also not plus hello. B index. And then the hand optimized version. And then mem set all the boxes. So for all the y, for all the width of the image. And there is source epsilon destination y less than z, source y than z plus plus y for accumulation. Clear this stuff as fast as possibly C optimized. Then because we need to go through all the boxes, Could this be that, is there anything? Oh, wait a second, maybe this is also wrong scale. There's a generic code, maybe there is something in regards to the same device. So we have here clear for accumulation, and then SY new image. Maybe that is similar to the scaling issue there. Also there in the Y index. XY, here's something, so for SY scale, oops, what was the other code, new image, so scale Y, new image divided by, maybe I should have copied this in whole B index, not to reinvent the wheel again, so this is here. I think actually this could be slightly optimized. I think new indexing in new image dot h should probably be the same where we have resize, probably somewhere here scale x. So probably this could be very tiny micro optimized, although I hope the C++ compiler nowadays is clever enough that this is the same in static and const and b index, but you never know. But it might even, well, does it? You see this some scale here, SX scale X, so there you even confuse this eventually. Where is our hand optimized B index? You're live on YouTube.
Yes, we're watching the video.
Very good.
Can you eat?
Yeah, you can eat already. I'm done soon, I guess. What are you doing? It's not like we are the YouTubers and open source developers don't need food. We live and work from peace and harmony and not paying customers. NY said so DX. I wonder how many more bugs are in here. So yeah, but again, also can you add like fixed size scaling and there? Yeah, then you have a couple of regressions because it's there. SY new image, what do even SY did I even wait a second, which version is it even? That is a generic, very clever. Here it is, SY, did I copy by the way now the whole for loop or still not? Okay, I did SY image H. So the rest is the same, so that is a new one, so I probably somehow overlooked this hand optimized code for that matter. Let's see if that fixes the second issue. Also, how can you have two issues? Well, it's the same, it's X direction, Y direction, so two bugs in there. Let's see if that fixes the thing. Also with best with 16. K and R tabs being two spaces and my coding style of choice. I think K and H wasn't a totally old school. Sounds like maybe two segmentation for different stuff. So now we get a segmentation fault for dividing dx. Probably overrunning some image somewhere. Box scale template. What is here? Box index dx new image. But this should only look this up. Dx count. So this is to set the box, and here is dx. There is not much to do except increment this. Looks relatively okay-ish though. Yep, there you see code is hard also. Yeah, you probably shouldn't open code this. B-index, what are we doing here even? So SY multiplied by so this of Z equals dy plus 1 sx. So this is bit shifting this stuff. Also, I think in the meantime, my new C++ template stuff could probably reach this speed. Actually, by the way, fun fact, I could just delete this code probably and the generic code would probably work, I guess. But fun fact, we could probably, yeah, of course, the really professional thing would be to first fix this and then benchmark it if this hand-optimized code is even still faster. Which boxes is box DX and then boxes plus gray lookup. Okay, this is doing some super fast gray lookup, so probably that is the reason why this is not hand-optimized, this for determining the gray value from the subbit gray stuff here. DX new image boxes DX, so new image width. Yeah, probably I fix this after the stream. We have SGI, so probably just a couple of more minutes, but family's hungry. Already checking up if I'm still alive here in my open source corner. So thanks for watching this kind of stuff, so you debug and stuff, and then sometimes even, especially, I personally also print C out stuff, totally low tech, but if you have massive amounts of data and stuff, and yeah, anyway, also, yes, it's, in my opinion, it's a healthy mix of sometimes print F stuff something and sometimes more precisely looking with a debugger, but I'm really wondering actually, where is this now, segmentation faulting in 631? 631 is still the same line. So we got from floating point division to segmentation faulting, maybe, which is, what is it even? So this should only segmentation fault. Is it a segmentation fault or eConvert? Did I over? Yes, oh, it's a segmentation fault. Funny stuff. Dest cannot access memory, or the destination is out of. That is interesting. Did I mess something up? Additionally to that, does this compute? That computes actually. I wanted. Cannot access memory, so count and destination are invalid. Count and destination. Count, so that is new image width, count and. So this is new image width and image width. As usual on the first glance. New image, what could possibly be still wrong here? Why for all? For all x to new image width? Maybe time to run it through Valgrind, which I may or may not have, probably not have installed here because it's a fresh VM. Emerge missing only Valgrind, because why not? Which, by the way, fun fact, is there a new version? But probably not. I think I recently updated that. Always when I need to install it, then yeah, let's see if there's a new version. Anyway, hope you learned something, although there are still some amazing people in the audience. What terminal is it? That is a cool, amazing vintage retro terminal, which certainly gives a